Hoosier Hospitality Wine is made possible in part by Visit Bloomington.com. Bloomington is home to two wineries as well as many other restaurants, shops, hotels, and festivals. Information on this and more at visitbloomington.com. By IU Lifelong Learning, celebrating 40 years of programs for adults in Bloomington and beyond, offering courses on the arts, world culture, politics, and leisure. Information at 812-855-9335. By IU Credit Union Investment Services, offering a full range of financial planning, retirement planning, and insurance services. Complimentary consultation available by calling 812-855-4803. And by WTIU members like you. Thank you.
Indiana has a rich heritage of grape growing and winemaking dating back to the early 1800s. Hello, I'm Lee Bush, and welcome to Hoosier Hospitality, Wine. Come with us as we visit the city of Vevey, nestled along the northern bank of the Ohio River. Vevey is said to be the site of the first successful commercial winery in the United States. And Indiana's wine industry is still thriving today. Hoosier Wineries produced 1.25 million gallons of wine last year. That usually ranks us around 13th among all of the states in the country.
The Midwest is by far the fastest growing wine industry in the United States.
Vintners have over 600 acres of wine grapes planted within Indiana's borders, and one winery alone harvested 170 tons of grapes. But when you're walking through a vineyard filled with lush green vines like these, you can't help but wonder how this fruit is transformed into an enjoyable glass of wine. We'd like to make you a part of that process as Indiana's vintners demonstrate different forms of canopy management found in their vineyards, the battles against frost in the spring, and the struggle of hand harvesting.
I think a lot of people don't realize just how labor-intensive a crop like grapes is.
Hoosier winemakers will explain the processes of crushing and destemming grapes, of fermentation in large stainless steel tanks, and of blending wine as they mold it into a specific taste profile.
Humans have been making wines for thousands of years, but often without really knowing what was going on, but that doesn't keep people from actually doing it.
Come along with me as we attend two of Indiana's wine tasting festivals, and you'll get exclusive behind-the-scene access to the judging at the Indy International Wine Competition. Along the way, we'll visit 7 Hoosier wineries representative of the wine industry found in Indiana today.
It's been a lot of fun, a ton of fun. We make a wine for heaven's sakes, it's good stuff.
As bountiful as grapes like these appear now, for over 200 years, early North American settlers had little success with starting vineyards in the New World. European grape varieties brought to this country encountered unexpected obstacles.
The grapes were not successful primarily because of diseases in North America and the colder temperatures.
Even well-known members of our founding fathers attempted to start a wine industry in this country, but success eluded them.
Thomas Jefferson was very interested in wine. He was probably the most noted wine connoisseur of his day. Jefferson ran into the same problems that other people did. He didn't have grape varieties that would adapt to the climate.
In 1796, Swiss immigrant John James Dufour came to America with the dream of starting a wine colony. He initially planted his grapevines near Lexington, Kentucky, at a site he called First Vineyard. But he continued to look for the ideal location to establish his Swiss wine colony.
When land came up for sale north of the Ohio River, a little section of Indiana was available for sale. And he petitioned Congress, he wrote letters to Jefferson, and he was trying to get the land on a special exemption, essentially get a deal. In the second year, they got the petition through, and they were allowed to buy roughly 2,400 acres over a 4-year period of time at a sort of a special interest rate.
When Dufour abandoned his first vineyard in Kentucky, he had to decide what grape varieties to take with him.
Well, of the 35 varieties of grapes that they had taken originally to First Vineyard, they only really took 2 that we know of to Indiana, and that was the Cape and the Madeira. And what they planted in Vivi was probably 90% or so of the Cape variety. But the Cape grape had the structure, the flower structure of the European variety. Therefore, they had assumed that it was a European grape. And this is really before the hybrids were even recognized. The Cape grape is what enabled them to really be the first successful wine production in the country.
Vive's location along the Ohio River helped generate business for the early Swiss winemakers.
The Ohio was the main highway going west at that time. And they would stop over at these little settlements and spend the night or go to on shore to buy products and trade.
This house that still stands today belonged to Dufour's brother-in-law, John Daniel Moreau. He was among the first Swiss settlers in Vivay. The house was the center of early commerce in the area.
If anyone deserves to be credited as America's first successful commercial winemaker, it's Moreau. He began recording wine sales in 1811 and continued to do so until 1835.
We have his records, and you can see and trace how much wine he was selling and who he was selling it to.
The stone stairs at the back of the house lead down to the cellar, but they also help us take a step into the past.
One of the greatest wine treasures of the Moreau house is hidden down here in the cellar. This is all that remains of the oldest barrel used for commercial wine production in the country.
The fact that they were able to have sustainable production, that they could distribute over a fairly wide area and really build up a market, is really what makes it a commercial industry. They were not home winemakers.
This photograph shows the Dufour House as it stood in the 1920s with the Ohio River seen on the left. But the property wasn't located near the rest of Dufour's Swiss family. John James Dufour chose not to live in Vivay with the rest of his family. Instead, he founded a farm upriver near Markland, proudly calling it Dufouria. This pile of bricks is all that remains of his modest dwelling where he lived alone.
He wrote The Vine Dresser's Guide, which was really the first book printed dealing with grape growing and winemaking in the United States. So he was really the first originator of new information for the new world on grape growing and winemaking. That book came out in 1826.
It's interesting. I reviewed The Vine Dresser's Guide when it was being republished by Purdue University Press a few years ago, and it's amazing. You look at 200-year-old recommendations, and Mr. Dufour really knew a lot more than we lost a lot of that wisdom over the years. You know, things about cluster thinning, you know, adjusting the crop load to balance the vines. He had that pretty well figured out. Those are the kind of things that we've sort of reinvented through research over the last 30 or 40 years. And it's interesting, an eye-opener when you go back and read a 200-year-old text and go, yeah, wow.
It's not just the Dufour house that's disappearing in the overgrown vegetation. A closer investigation reveals another surprise hidden in the weeds.
It is in this old family cemetery behind his house that John James Dufour is buried. It is a less than adequate memorial for the man who started the commercial wine industry here in Indiana as well as in the United States.
For the next 100 years, Indiana's wine industry remained relatively stable. The completion of the Transcontinental Railroad turned out to be a great boost for California's wine grape industry. But Prohibition shut down the industry for everybody. And when it was finally repealed, heavy government regulation still remained.
You had a few states at the end of Prohibition which restarted their wine industries because they had a distribution system that allowed wineries to sell directly to the public. To restart a winery and sell directly to the public, you can make money. In Indiana, you could only sell to a wholesaler. And then the wholesaler sells it to the retailer then sells it to the customer. That's the three-tiered system that we still have today.
So restarting the wine industry came a little later in Indiana than in some other states. But a group of ardent home winemakers finally convinced the Indiana legislature it was time for a change.
The rebirth of the wine industry was 1971, the passage of the Small Winery Act, and that allowed a winery to be the producer, the wholesaler, and the retailer all rolled into one. And we had several wineries start up 1972 right away. The people involved in that, the primary person was Bill Oliver Sr. There were several other people who were also interested in it. They sort of banded together, petitioning the government, be allowed to do something. And they were successful in getting a petition through.
A lot of the people in the legislature are lawyers that graduated from IU and were students of Bill Oliver, you know? So, you know, I think it, you know, one has to think Bill Oliver had more than just a casual relationship there to get this thing done.
I recall once someone telling my dad that he was making wine before it was cool, and that would go back to the 1960s as a home hobbyist. We did a lot of kind of, I would call, sort of guerrilla marketing back in the day. That was a grape stomping competition, and those classic cutoff jeans that I wore back in the 1970s. That is a Oliver Winery site, I would say, a month after we purchased it, and a hand-painted sign that I would bet my mother put together. That really shows our humble beginnings.
The Oliver Winery grounds just outside of Bloomington look much different today. And yet, as impressive as the facility appears, it's his Creek Bend vineyard that Bill Oliver is most proud of.
We grow 53 acres of Creek Bend. That's a really important part of what we do. If we have a good year, we ought to be able to get about 300 tons out there, which would be enough to make about 15,000 cases. We make over 300,000 cases a year. So what's that work out to, about 3%? It's bigger than 3% of the wines we make, if you just look at the wine list.
And the number one seller on Oliver's wine list is their soft red.
We didn't envision that wine becoming huge. I mean, really, there was no business model that this thing is going to be just gigantic someday. But people liked it, and we just started to make more, started selling it through distribution. They would order more, we'd make more, and now it's half of our production. I think millennial consumers are much more open-minded and also much more concerned about ethical farming practices and buying local. I think we have a huge advantage there. It's a no-brainer. We are local. We're the real deal. And ultimately, we'd like to rebuild the winery right here where we are. We really want to build a state-of-the-art, beautiful showcase winery that will absolutely blow people away. That's probably 6-8 years from now. That's our vision.
Bill Oliver's vision sounds exciting now, but the outlook for the wine industry wasn't quite as promising in the 1960s. Back then, there were little more than 500 wineries in the United States. By the late 80s, that number had blossomed to 5,000. Indiana's relatively small number of commercial winemakers anticipated the same kind of renaissance here, but the local wineries knew they were going to need direction and, most of all, money to make this happen.
The Indiana Wine Grape Council was started in 1989, although I think it was imagined by Bill Oliver Sr., Jim Butler, were already vintners, commercial vintners in Indiana, and the Purdue Department of Agriculture.
And what the Wine Council does is it collects 5 cents per gallon on the excise tax paid on all wine in the state. That's 5 cents per gallon.
To fund a program that would put together a viticulturist, an enologist, and a marketing person to enhance, develop, promote the Indiana grape and wine industry.
With the Indiana Wine Grape Council up and running on the Purdue campus, wineries in the state had a partner to help them pursue their dreams.
The most common question is, what variety should I grow, or what's the best to grow, or can I grow Merlot or Cabernet Sauvignon or something like that? Soils are what a lot of people think is the main concern with grape growing, and actually grapes are widely adapted to a wide range of soils. Grapes are the most widely grown fruit crop in the world. If they were really specific to certain soils, they wouldn't be grown on such a wide range of soil types.
Now, from the production standpoint, we have Christian Butzke, who brings together a twofold background. He's born in Europe and trained in our country, so he has the old world, new world sort of approach.
I thought it was a really neat challenge to come to the Midwest, which is one of the historic, one of the oldest historic wine growing regions in the United States, but also kind of a pioneering new wine growing region. In fact, right here in this very wine library, we bring aspiring winemakers, and we have a critical discussion of what it takes to be a successful winemaker. We usually say the difference between a successful home winemaker and a successful commercial winemaker is that a good home winemaker makes good wine 75% of the time. The remaining 25%, that's pretty much your profit margin there. So if you screw up 25% of your winemaking on a commercial level, that's not good enough. As a commercial winemaker, I would say you have to be at least 90% successful all the time.
I am the marketing director for the industry, so it is my job to make sure our industry is well publicized. So I have the pleasure of doing a lot of social media, news releases, and general advertising efforts. But it is my job to also help the individual winery if they need help writing a news release, or they need help putting together a marketing plan, or they need help designing a label for a wine bottle. Then I will work with the wineries one-on-one. But overall, I'm here to promote the Indiana wine industry as a whole.
Indiana's young wine industry still had hurdles to overcome. Another legislative issue to be addressed was Sunday sales of their product.
Sunday sales for Indiana wine, 1982, that was done by the Hubers. And they had a nice business going down there, U-Pick and the winery, and just bringing lots of people in, but they couldn't sell wine on Sunday. So they petitioned the state, got a law passed. Frank O'Bannon was the person who was really the big help there, but that was Gerald Huber who got that through.
The Huber family has been growing fruit in southern Indiana for many generations.
We're the sixth generation to own and operate the farm. It was established in 1843 by a German settler named Simon Huber.
The Hubers jumped on board as soon as the Indiana legislature passed the law allowing for the establishment of wineries. They immediately started planting grapes and looking for a site for their winery.
And this beautiful barn again was the perfect spot to house the winery. And they started making wine commercially in 1977, and the doors opened in spring of 1978. The first wine would have been one of the big crops that we had is strawberry. And strawberry wine requiring very little, if any, real aging. So it was the first wine ready to go. So it was the first wine down the bottling line.
I think 1983 we planted our first vineyard.
And a lot of those vineyards are still in full production. Right now we're sitting on a little over 70 acres.
I think we're the biggest or second biggest grape grower in the state.
We're considerably larger than most American wineries. And even in the California standard, we're much larger than those guys. Our estimates last year, we made a little bit less than 50,000 cases.
Huber Winery is obviously selling a lot of wine right now, but it was Grandma Huber who created their best seller.
She worked with myself both in the vineyards and the production over several years to develop a wine that her grandfather and father helped her make, and so it eventually became Sweet Marcella. A few years before Grandma passed away, she got to see the wine go all the way into being the number one selling wine here at the winery. This is a great business, and I always said I'll keep doing it as long as it's fun. So that's kind of what my key to success is.
The secret of success for bountiful vineyards like this is year-round attention. You might imagine that winter would be a downtime for work in the vineyard, but the cold temperatures have little impact on preparing the vines for the next growing season.
What we're doing today is pruning the vines, getting them ready for spring. Basically, what the pruning does is it prepares the vine for our crop load for next year.
After some mechanical pruning, the vines require a trained hand and a trained eye to make the final pruning decisions.
We are taking the vines down to approximately 48 buds of last year's wood. This will give us a set crop load in the following year.
Pruning also takes place during the spring when the vineyard first shows signs of coming back to life.
This time of year, we're at the point we call bud break, and this is when the vines are coming out into leaf. Grapes are one of those crops where limiting the production is good. Unlike corn and soybeans, where you want to produce as much as you can. So we need to prune off 95% of what grew last year to limit the production to these few buds that will produce the very good quality wine.
Spring is also when planting new vines takes place. This newly planted vineyard near Huntington, Indiana, belongs to the Two E's Winery. It's one of the early stages of a big dream.
These first two rows are Traminette. We've got 24 vines to a row. Here we've got Brianna. We actually were expecting to get Golden Muscat, and I don't know if the nursery we ordered the vines from made that mistake or if we just clicked the wrong one. We've got a little less than 400. If there would be 25 vines to a row, there would be exactly 400.
One of the biggest decisions in starting a vineyard is choosing what varieties of grapes to plant.
We kind of want to push the boundaries of people's expectations and use some varieties that are a little less known. Bruce Bordelon has given us a lot of advice in what we should do with our vineyard. He's been a little more in the sense of just plant Traminette or just plant some things that you know will work, and I guess we were a little resistant to that. We wanted to push the limits of that.
When completed, the winery's new building will house the tasting room, a merchandising area, as well as all of the production facilities.
Right now, we're standing at the front doors. So this is where all the where you can enter the winery. And we're gonna have, this is a vestibule area, so you have the doors here and then another set of doors, so you enter here. We're gonna have a nice seating area where people can sit and look at the vines, feel like they're right in the vineyard, which I think is really important when you come to a winery, to be able to see the grapes and see where it all begins. I didn't realize there were so many approvals, so many submittals to state. That was a big surprise to me. And dirt too, dirt was a big one too.
It's you know, not the way they make it seem in the movies or magazines. You know, there's not a fancy winemaker with a tuxedo always standing next to barrels tasting wine. It's a lot of hard work and boots.
Not all glamorous.
It's like winemaking is not all glamorous, no.
Whether you're a new winery or a well-established one, watching your vines green up in the spring is both exciting and worrying.
Normally, bud break is right around the, between the 10th and 15th of April. So we're a good 3 weeks ahead of the normal bud break. So we've got a lot of time to worry about frost and freezes. What we have for operation are our orchard right fans, and these fans will pull warm air from the upper currents in the right climatic conditions and blow it around in the vineyard, and that moving of that warm air will actually raise the temperatures in the vineyard anywhere from 3 to 5 degrees. The gods have smiled on us, and we have this breeze going, and I believe altogether it has held up the temperatures so that we didn't get any damage so far.
But then, just a little over a week later, as the moon went down, so did the temperatures.
Just looking at the weather and everything forecast, I was pretty sure there was going to be an event to happen this morning. So had my phone sitting beside me waiting for the alarm to happen. And when that alarm went off, I got up and turned the fans on.
The computer's record of the minute-by-minute temperature fluctuations tells the story of another worrisome night in the vineyard.
I actually started the fans about 4:27, went from 30.2 at 4:25, and it climbed by 4:37. The temperature had gone back up to 34 degrees.
As the sun came up and started to warm the vines, it revealed the effects of the frosty spring night. Faced with even colder temperatures forecast for April 12th, Oliver Winery decided more drastic measures were needed to save their tender early vines in their Creek Bend vineyard.
Going into the night, Noah said about 30 degrees would be the low. We had this gentleman stop by last week offering helicopter services. So we gave him a call and set it up for him to come out. He came out last night. We came up with a plan to try and protect the rest of the vineyard along with the fans.
comes out of this field, you know, he's kind of S-ing through here, which is good. I want him to come out and cut around this back edge. Yeah, this back area here, it's down to 25.
They're covering the areas that the fans are not able to get to. There is a definite increase in the temperatures where they're going. We set them up with a pattern that can get them back to their starting point every 5 to 6 minutes so that they can push that warm air back down. Somewhere between 12 to 24 hours, we should know whether we've got some damage.
It was a tough time for us. I mean, talk about just nerve-wracking, anxiety-provoking, unfun situation for us to be in. And that event of April 12th, 13th, and 14th was really the battle when we had the helicopter out there, the frost fans running in. We're in the mid-20s, and that's just death for a butted-out vineyard. But with the helicopters and the frost fans, we saved 70% of our crop. And so it was, it worked.
Not every Indiana vineyard has the resources to bring in a helicopter to save their vines. Ertl Sellers Winery could only sit back and hope the forecasters were wrong.
This, as you can see, is severe, severe frost damage. The temperatures here got down to 27.1 degrees. 28 degrees is the line. You can see the clusters. You can see there was the grapes. There one, there's one, there's one hiding in there. So we got a severe loss. We'll have some secondaries break and we'll get a small crop out of here, but what would have been 6 tons of grapes will certainly be no more than 3.
As the growing season progresses, the vines need a little assistance to maximize their ability to ripen the grapes.
What we're doing is we're trying to get all the shoots in a single layer if possible, so that for shoots that have fruit growing off of them, the leaves are exposed to the sunlight, and that just provides more energy to the shoot and maximizes the photosynthesis.
Ertl Sellers Winery near Batesville does their share of canopy management as well. 75% of their wine product comes from grapes that they grow.
We have 13 acres of grapes, primarily located in two locations, split about 50-50, about 12 miles apart. Part of that is to protect ourselves from disease and also from frost.
My background in winemaking goes back 22 years. I started when I was 18 years old, started in the vineyards.
I wanted to have the winery in the country, and so I didn't want it along a busy interstate or a highway, et cetera. And so then the challenge in my mind was, what do you do in terms of continually being able to attract customers? And so I elected to have a restaurant, and I felt like a white tablecloth restaurant, reasonably priced, would attract the locals as well as being able to attract people from, you know, the greater Indianapolis and Cincinnati area.
This is a labor of love, you know, really serious job, and it's not as romantic as it sounds. I love my job. I love what I do for a living. Couldn't be more blessed. I come to work as happy as I go home.
Obviously, we don't have the capital to you know, run advertisements on TV, et cetera, like a well-established winery would. So it's a challenge in terms of branding. So we do a lot of, you know, we do a lot of wine pourings throughout the state, et cetera, to promote our wines.
As you can see by the sign, I'm here in Story, Indiana, home of the Story and Wine Festival. This is the 10th year of the event, which was established to feature Indiana's wineries. There are over 25 wineries at this festival, which gives them the opportunity to showcase the fruits of their labor.
To get your name out in front of this many people in one spot, we won't have a chance at the winery to pull in whatever 3,000, 4,000 people that this event has today.
All the people, all the wine, I mean, it's any kind of wine you want to taste, dry, sweet, whatever. You'll find something you like.
We've been here, what, like 8 years in a row?
In a row.
It's good to hang out with the girlfriends, have some good wine,
check out all the new wineries in Indiana.
This is actually our 20th anniversary, and we've never been to wine tasting, so it was something different, something new to try to do.
And we're very thankful to have the opportunity to come out and participate in festivals like this where there are multiple wineries and we can market to different individuals who may not know of our winery or know where we are located.
Gotta tell you, it's the people, the wine, just being around the whole atmosphere of just being around what Indiana's all about.
It's fun.
This is really my first time actually drinking wine and trying everything out, so come here to learn a little bit, you know, meet some of the vendors, talk to them about what I would like, you know, that kind of thing. So I'm just here to learn and taste some stuff and have a good time.
Military Park in downtown Indianapolis is the site of another Indiana Wine Tasting Festival. Sponsored by the Indiana Wine Grape Council, it obviously attracts a very large crowd.
Vintage Indiana is the biggest wine festival in the state, held on the first weekend in June, and we have nearly 30 wineries who will participate in this festival, and it's an effort to educate Indiana about wine.
Vintage Indiana was created in June of 2000. The first year, 3,500 people turned out to taste Indiana wine. This year, over 10,000 wine enthusiasts are expected to attend the event.
We've made some great friends coming to events like this. We'll sell some cases of wine today, but that's not the reason we're here. We're here to meet people.
There's a lot of people that don't get to where we live. We're in Madison, Indiana. It's only 90 minutes from 465, but people think it's a little farther away or they haven't heard of us. They get to come here and get a little exposure, see the style of wine we make.
We all have a good time, and we love Indiana wine.
Yeah. Indiana wine is awesome.
I had no idea there was so many
nice
Indiana wine.
I didn't either.
It's a marketing tool, absolutely. No doubt about it. Plus, we sell a lot of wine. That's the other thing.
We just enjoy the Indiana wines, and we like some of the fruit wines.
Your first time here, nobody knows who you are. You don't do too well. But that second year, they just hammer you. So it's a great, this is probably one of the best festivals in the state right now.
So by bringing wineries to Central Indiana, it lets 10,000 people come and enjoy a day and really get an education about wine without having to drive to all the far reaches of the state to visit these wineries.
Another marketing effort initiated by the Indiana Wine Grape Council was the designation of a signature Indiana wine.
When we looked at the opportunity to put Indiana on the wine map, we looked at the opportunity of promoting a signature wine. And we kind of joked that if Indiana had a state pie, then we could be known for a wine too. So when the industry sat down and started looking at grapes that grow around Indiana and what could grow from north to south and east to west, a Traminette was the wine and the grape that came to the forefront.
It had been grown pretty widely in the New York region. And when we started growing it here in the Midwest, we saw that we could really get outstanding quality, much better than they were getting in New York. We were getting this full floral character from our vineyards with it.
We have crisper, maybe more citrus, based Traminettes from northern Indiana, wines that have more the aromas of lemons and limes and an orange blossom. If you go further south, you get riper characters, the passion fruit, the mango, the ripe peaches. So you get very unique and different styles for one variety.
People now hear Traminette and they think Indiana, and they go into a winery, and many of our wineries say the first thing they ask for is Traminette because they've heard of it.
And I think Traminette's made in Indiana better than any other state. I firmly believe that.
We do it very well here.
The French Lick Winery opened in 1995, but more recently their Traminette has had quite an impact.
We've done very well with Traminette. We had the White Wine of the Year a few years ago with our Traminette.
But when John Doty first thought about starting his own business, someone else had some input on what he would ultimately end up doing.
My wife and I both wanted to start our own business for years, and but we had such different ideas. She wanted a flower shop or something foo-foo like that, and
you know, I wanted something with a farm or, you know, something like that. So we compromised. We wanted to be in the black in our first 5 years, and we were in the black after 2 years, and we've just continued to grow since then. We've always tried to have a full selection of wines. When a customer comes, you know, I want them to find something they like, whether they're a dry wine drinker from California, or if they like the sweeter dessert type wine. So we have a full wine list. We actually have 22 wines on our list.
In an effort to make the winery more of a destination, the Doty's opened their Vintage Cafe.
Our wine sales quadrupled immediately when we put the restaurant in. It was just amazing, the difference. We deliberately went with the Italian, you know, the spicy Italian menu, and French Lick Red goes really good with pizza and spaghetti and lasagna and, you know, all those things we make. You know, you go to a liquor store and you buy a bottle of wine and you really don't know what you're getting until you get it home. But at Indiana Wineries, you can come and actually taste the wine before you purchase, and you know what you're buying. Plus, it's just a really fun experience.
But that fun experience couldn't happen without the labor-intensive hand harvesting that takes place in Indiana vineyards.
We're going to start off with the Valvin Muscat today. I'm going to put four of you on each row, so two on that end, two on this end. You guys go ahead down on the end of 10 and start working this direction. And why don't you, two of you, go ahead down here on the end of 9.
As harvesting begins, Oliver Winery expands their seasonal part-time workforce. Although there are usually some returning veterans, the first-timers need to be brought up to speed with some coaching.
One that is a really woolly variety, so we're really gonna have to get in there.
Okay.
So you'll reach up, kind of just cradle them underneath your hand. Don't grab the whole thing with your hand or you'll cut off the top of your fingertip.
Huber Winery manages their harvest workforce differently. Because their property produces many fruits in addition to grapes, they utilize the migrant workers that are working on the property most of the year.
This is one of these really good days for harvesting. We're having really nice, cool mornings, which the grapes are coming in right now in the 50s coming into the cellar. We've been watching this particular variety since about the last week of July, and we've been monitoring the progression of the pH, the total acidity, and also the Brix level, which is the sugar level of the grape. We've been monitoring this on about an every 3 to 4 day basis, going all the way through the month of August. And then we've been doing it about every other day as we've been going through in September. Today is the most important day of the life of the wine. This particular block right here should yield to somewhere around the 1,500 to 1,700 gallons. And so they're coming off fairly good this year. This has been a really good vintage. We had no frost damage this particular spring, no winter damage over last winter. So the fruits, every fruit bud that we had was successful. And so we're looking at a full crop of this particular variety.
After the trip from the vineyard, the grapes are loaded into the crusher destemmer.
I see a little too much maceration. We don't want to get into the where we're damaging the seeds. So I'm opening up the wheels a little bit on there, so when these fall through, they'll just only barely get split open. We've taken the stems out. Stems don't taste good, so we take them out.
You see, we're sorting the fruit. We're trying to make sure there's nothing coming in from the vineyard that we don't want to make wine from. So we're actually hand sorting the fruit as it comes in.
So we're coming in here from the destemmer crusher, and we're going into the press. We'll get about 70% of the juice out of there without even applying any pressure. It takes us about an hour to load, hour and a half to load about 10 tons worth of fruit in there, and then we'll run that press cycle to get that remaining, you know, 25-30% of juice that remains in those wet skins.
The real magic in winemaking takes place during fermentation. That's when the miracle of changing juice into wine actually takes place.
Fermentation is yeast feeding on sugar and fruit or fruit juice and producing alcohol and carbon dioxide. You know, it's the alcohol we're after, right?
Fermentation takes place in large stainless steel tanks. These help the winemaker control the temperature and the amount of oxygen that the immature wine is exposed to.
So I keep my fermentations around 48 degrees, which stretches that fermentation out to 5 or 6 weeks. That's what you have to keep your Treminet and Vignole fruity. And when you slow ferment, it rolls that alcohol flavor to the back of your palate and your fruit forward, and that's what we have to have.
Reds, we ferment warm.
Now we do our red skins, like Cab and Chamberson, on the skins, no chilling, and they'll get 90 degrees easy.
We think that the red wines fermented warm have a better tactile sensation in the mouth. It's called mouthfeel, sort of a nice filling, coating kind of a characteristic that nice red wines have.
Sadek Winery, located near Fremont, Indiana, is looking for that same characteristic in its wines.
We have two that are doing very well for us right now. That's Coro Noir, and then there's Larry's Luscious as a dry red wine that is a blend of Coro Noir, Noiré, and Chamberson.
With a PhD in chemistry, Larry Sadek started experimenting with winemaking as early as 1975.
In 1999, we made the choice to finally decide to pull the trigger and actually start the real winery. And so we purchased this property, which is 16 acres at the intersection of I-69 and the toll road because of its location. Our business plan called for us to be about 10,000 gallons now. And we are about twice that. So we have exceeded expectations. We want our customers to come in and know that the wines they are tasting are good wines. So last year, and most years, we submit most, if not all, of our wines to international wine competitions. Last year, we won 28 medals. We actually produce about 35 different wines, of which we have 25 or so out at any one time. There are probably two philosophies in winemaking. One of them is that you make the best pure varietal that it's possible to make, and you never blend in anything. And the other one is you blend for a style of wine that you want, and you make it the best style that you want by blending in the grapes. I unabashedly subscribe to the second style.
Right now I'm just trying to size up the oak integration in this particular wine.
2% of another variety in a blend, one would think that would be imperceptible, but occasionally it's like, wow, that's great.
I'm gonna put her in here. And this happens to be a brand new American oak barrel with the estate grown Cabernet Sauvignon that we have right now. So I'm gonna bring this over. Now this is still only two grape varieties that are going to end up being five different grape varieties for sure going into there. Put a little bit more into it. And so now we've built the wine up. We started with a lighter, fruitier style that is the base for this generation's, and we now brought in Cabernet Sauvignon, which is very heavy, nice fruit character, and we're starting building the structure of the wine up, giving it more of a finish.
If we're growing grapes that are not well known by their varietal names, then you don't lose much by blending to make a better wine and coming up with a proprietary name. I think we're going to see more of that in the future.
One of the things you don't see a lot of is a winery located in the heart of a large metropolitan area. Easley Winery, located in downtown Indianapolis since 1974, has been a success story in spite of their location.
The winery started as a dream of my mother and father, Jack and Joan Easley. My mother had a market research business, and my father was an attorney. They began in 1974 processing the grapes that they had planted in 71 and 72.
Jack Easley's vineyard was located in Crawford County along the Ohio River, but the long drive didn't keep him from overseeing the harvest.
You're going to find some bird damage today. If the bird damage isn't too bad, pick it.
Pretty emotional seeing him lead a group of, 30 to 40 harvesters out picking the crop and, realizing that that's a whole year's worth of work that began probably 5 or 6 years previous.
This early video demonstrates how the whole Easley family was part of the business.
My sister is a people person. In that video, she was leading crews and directing folks where to park and interacting with the picking crew. And I was back in the metal building with the production cycle. We would take the harvested grapes and run them through stemmer crushers.
In a bladder press, you've got a mass that's about that thick, and you're trying to control pressures. And you can do it very nicely, get it just where you want it, and hold it there. This press is really a honey.
It's that family involvement that Mark Easley is so proud of still today.
Success has a lot of measures, and I would probably say, for me personally, it comes down to the family involvement, and the fact that we are able to make a living, pay the bills, have everyone together, and be proud of what we're producing and doing. That's my success. My wife and I, Meredith, took over. We were in the 5,000-6,000 gallon range, very boutique, a hands-on winery, selling a lot of wine and juice to other wineries. And now to be focused on just our operation, and now to be up, a little over 90,000 gallons, that's an accomplishment.
When the winemaker decides his product is finally ready for the public, bottling begins. How mechanized that process is varies greatly from one winery to another.
It's a continual process of taking a bottle, putting the hose in it to displace the air with carbon dioxide, take the bottle that has just had the carbon dioxide put in it, put it in the bottler, take another bottle off, put it in the corker, go back and take a new bottle, take the hose out, put it in the new bottle, take the bottle that was just displaced. We'll generally bottle up to 500 gallons a day with this kind of a process.
Bottling at Butler Winery takes a little less eye-hand coordination.
The first unit is a filler corker, so it fills the bottles. That is a leveler. It's putting in carbon dioxide and forcing out the excess wine. So you have a little carbon dioxide under the cork. It helps protect the wine when it puts the cork in. And then the next station is the heat shrinker. It puts the capsule on. And then finally, the label goes on.
As the level of sophistication increases in the bottling process, so does the cost of the machinery. That makes purchasing decisions difficult.
One of the decisions we decided was if wine quality was going to prevail, we had to really control oxygen. And we were getting too much oxygen in our bottling process. And to say that it was a traumatic time to buy that bottling line operation is an understatement. It was 2 years of sheer family turmoil of can we afford this or can we afford not to do this? We went to three bankers and convinced one of them that we were worth the bet, and they took a risk on us. The balance sheet wasn't there to justify that size of a loan, but I would have to look at that as one of the changing moments for our operation.
With the wine finally in bottles, it's time to convince the public to buy your product. And one of the best tools to market a wine is for it to be judged a winner in tasting competitions. A few days before the Indiana Wine Fair at Story, Indiana, the wineries that attend the event submit their wines to a council of judges. The wines compete for awards in 7 categories.
And when it's all over, we tally it up, and the highest 3 scores are gold, silver, bronze.
While hiding the identity of the wines in brown paper bags gives the competition a rather informal look, a win can still be a point of pride for a winery.
That's something we do just because the marketing people really like to talk about the awards.
But it's the Indy International Wine Competition that is the benchmark for wine contests in Indiana. Managed by the Indiana Wine Grape Council, the event is held annually on the campus of Purdue University.
So this is an international wine competition, and that means that wineries from around the world, 15 different countries, 38 states here in the U.S., are sending in their wines that they made. They pay a fee to have the wines judged here. They are being judged against, in this case, 2,500 other wines that other winemakers have sent in. I've assembled a group of 52 professional wine judges. Those are people that have a good amount of experience in wine, with wine.
We judge each wine by ourselves, put our comments and score what medal or no medal it ought to get. And then once everybody's done with all the wines of a particular flight, we look at each other's scores, and if they're similar, we move on to the next wine. If there's big differences, we'll say, hey, what did you see that the rest of us didn't see? And we can revise our scores then.
I have the pleasure of judging at the Indy International Wine Competition. This is probably my 10th year in a row or so forth. And it's a wonderful competition that highlights wines from around the world.
It's really interesting because this is run in a very similar format to one of our international competitions in the UK.
This year we have, I believe, 322 Indiana wines entered. That alone shows you how diverse a market that has become, how many choices the consumers have just for Indiana wines.
I think the quality of the ones I've tasted, and I have tasted a few over the couple of days I've been here, it's very good. It shows people, certainly around the country, but also overseas, that they produce wines, and when you see the list of awards, it shows that they can produce very good wines.
Another Concordance Gold, a double gold for Treminet. That better be from Indiana. It must be from Indiana.
Setup for competition on the third and final day of judging requires some adjustments, but when the venue is ready, the judges are called in.
This is it.
Ladies and gentlemen, please come on in. We have 34 wines in front of you. Taste through all of them.
Then it was time to pick the best red, white, rosé, sparkling, and dessert wine of the year. But this time, the judges literally stand up for the wine of their choice.
Who would like to stand up? Pinot Gris, anybody? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7.
With the voting finalized, the winners were presented to the judges. And there was a proud Indiana wine among the winners.
The Rosé Wine of the Year comes from Indiana this year, Catawba Rosé from Huber Winery. And so again.
Beat everything else that was submitted from 17 countries. Wow, still gets me.
For our wineries to participate in this competition and win major trophies and major medals shows that what we're doing here in Indiana with our wine is second to none.
Wineries are not an easy business. It's like any other business where you're making a product, but we have this long lag time.
The number of wineries in Indiana has doubled just since I started here 6-7 years ago.
It's a great business. It has an amazing customer base.
A lot of Hoosiers will testify that Indiana wine wasn't the best 20 years ago. Now they're winning medals all the time.
At the end of the day, people just got to think that your wines are great and they're a good value.
For us, it's a matter of getting to consumers and presenting them our product and making them feel comfortable that it's okay to select an Indiana wine.
The higher the quality,
each individual winery, the more successful we all will be.
We can clearly see that more people enjoy those local wines, more people are buying it, and that wouldn't happen if people wouldn't like those wines.
We're not just corn, soybeans, and pigs anymore. You know, we are grapes and wine just as well. And I think that's very important to our industry.
It's that all-encompassing focus on the product, the wine. How is the wine going to taste when somebody pulls the cork out, pours it for their dinner, for their friends, their family, their neighbors?
I don't see wine at the Indiana 500 and maybe never will. I mean, you know, the winner drinks milk. Probably never get them to drink Traminette.
We pick the business because we like living the business, and we're very happy with our decision.